So we give thanks for the gospel that we get to do do-overs. So I'd like to welcome those of you who are online. It turned out the batteries on my microphone were dead, so you couldn't hear me. We've replaced them with new batteries. And if you are online, I invite you to say hello or something in the comments or praise God or something. Let us know that you are worshiping with us this morning. Our attendance is almost like a third in-house, a third YouTube, and a third Facebook, or actually more on Facebook than the other two. And so we're glad that we have this medium to be able to reach out and to share the love of Jesus Christ with so many different people. We are reminded of our mission statement, and that is praising God, making disciples, and serving all. Praising God, making disciples, and serving all. That's who we are. That's what we're about. That is why we are here each and every time that we gather together. I also want to let you know, and I want to thank Luann for the prayer cards in your pews. And so if you have a joy or a concern, there should be little white cards in your pew. It says prayer card on it. And you can write your joy or concern down. That's really helpful for me for a couple reasons. One, it helps me when I can't hear you, I can see it on the card. And it also gives us a record so we could put that in the bulletin to be praying during the week as well. So if you have a joy or concern, please fill out a prayer card. And either I or the ushers will come by right before at prayer time and collect those cards from you. And if you are online, you're invited to use the comment section. Now, we haven't gotten anybody here trained yet, but hopefully some of you will look online around joys and concerns time and see if there are any joys or concerns and let me know. And we will share those as well from online if we get them at the appropriate time. I want you to look at the front cover of your bulletin. If you are online, we put a PDF out to everyone that we have an email address for. And at the bottom, just this wonderfully popular statement. That's being facetious, okay? About our COVID-19 mitigation policy for indoor worship and meetings here at the church. Now, this was set before I came, but I am in full agreement with it. Vaccinated persons do not need to wear a mask. That's CDC guidelines. If you are vaccinated, you don't need to wear a mask. You should be okay, and the possibilities of you transferring COVID to somebody else are much slimmer. Not impossible, but slimmer. If you don't want to wear a mask, I mean, if you are not vaccinated, then you need to wear a mask. That's simple. Nobody says you have to like it. I hate masks, okay? But if you're not vaccinated, you need to wear a mask. And if you don't want to get vaccinated and you don't want to wear a mask, we have this wonderful gift called online worship. And you can sit at home and, or, you know, wherever you are with your phone or your tablet, and participate in worship via online. So we have those three options, and want to just let you all know. I think most of you know that already, but I have had some people come up to me and say, you know, Pastor, there are people in church who are not vaccinated and who are not wearing a mask. So we're not going to do a police patrol. We're not going to do that. Honor system is what? Honor system. We expect that you're going to respect the people around you. And so if you are not vaccinated, you're going to wear a mask. And if you don't want to do either vaccination or a mask, you're going to watch from home. So thank you. Thank you for doing that. Now that everybody's now mad at me, Staff Parish Relations Committee is working on two major projects right now. One is cottage meetings that will begin probably late fall. Be an opportunity for me to travel around and meet in people's homes and in small groups, 6 to 8 people. We're not going to do groups of 50 people or 30 people, but kind of intimate groups where we can talk and share together. And so they're looking for hosts, so talk to Michelle or somebody on SBR and let them know if you can be a host. All the host has to do is open up your home and have some chairs and maybe some light refreshments, not a meal. Light refreshments, and we'll just kind of have about 2 hours of eating and talking. Can you all handle that, eating and talking? Does that work here? All right, I've been doing a little bit more eating than I've been doing talking, and so I'm looking forward to that. And then also in September, once people are back from vacations and summer break, we're going to have 30 days of prayer, 30 days of intensive prayer for God's work in our community, in this church, and in our lives and the lives of those who are hurting. Friends, this is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it as we continue to worship God this morning.
Thank you, Pastor Stu. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Those of you in the sanctuary, please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship. As one body of Christ, we gather together this day, blessed by one Spirit.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Give me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it. Name of God's redeeming love. Hitherto thy love has blessed me, thou hast brought me to his place. And I know thy hand will bring me safely home by thy good grace. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God.
Now, please join me in the opening prayer and bow our heads. Speak truth to us today, O God. Speak truth to the most inward parts of our hearts and minds, that we might speak your truth in love, and that you might speak your truth through each of us each day. In your holy name we pray. Amen. It's hard to bow your heads and see that. I'm sorry. And please remain standing for the opening prayer. There's an asterisk here, right? Just the scripture? Okay. I mean, for the scripture. And for the scriptures, actually, you can sit. So that's... Yeah, that's confusing. Sorry. I'll stand. You guys sit. Let's have it that way. So the first scripture reading is Psalm 51, 1 through 12. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain on my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin, for I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have not done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. But you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy. Again, you have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. And now the second reading is John 6, 24 through 35. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went across to Capernaum to look for them. They found him on the other side of the lake and asked, Rabbi, when did you get here? And Jesus replied, Oh, I tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you, not because you understood the miraculous signs, but don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. For God the Father has given me the seal of his approval. They replied, But we want to perform God's work too. What should we do? And Jesus said, This is the only work of God wants from you. Believe in the one he has sent. And then they answered, Show us a miraculous sign if you want us to believe in you. What can you do? After all, our ancestors ate manna while they journeyed through the wilderness. The scriptures say Moses gave them bread from heaven to eat. So Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Moses didn't give you bread from heaven. My Father did. And now he offers you the true bread from heaven. The true bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, give us the bread every day. And Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. This is the word of God for us.
I'd like to invite all the children to come on up and join me. Paul might have been confused about sitting and standing, but I'm not. I'm going to sit. Have a seat. Come on, Jordan. I know. I'm so excited you guys are here today. Thank you. This is awesome. All right. So I'm going to stick my notes down here. Oh, you can't peek yet. It's my goodie bag. All right. So how's it going, guys? Good? Did you have a good week? Okay, yeah, mommy's right there. I gotta show you something. Guess what I got this week?
Sure.
I got these really cool new shades. What do you think? You know what's awesome about these?
Can we try these?
Hold on, I'm gonna show you. Guess what I can do with these?
Yeah.
I can put them right on top of my glasses. Yay, and I can still see. Yeah, because, what? It's your birthday. I know, Jude. We're going to sing happy birthday to you down in junior church, okay? All right. But, okay, hold on. So I want to show you something else. I did not realize until I in my house how many pairs of sunglasses I had. I got to show you all these. Check these out. Ooh, they're pretty funky. And then I got these. And I got these. These are reader ones, so I can read. Hold on. Yep, and I got these. I got all these different pairs. Oh, and these are my latest ones. I got these because these are half, they're bifocal sunglasses. I've had trouble seeing lately. Anyway, all these sunglasses. Do you know what sunglasses do? What do sunglasses do? Exactly, they protect your eyes from the sun. When you go outside on a really bright summer day, it helps to have sunglasses. Now, sunglasses protect your eyes, but you know, makes me think that there may be other ways to protect our eyes. You know what's another way to protect our eyes? We can protect them by maybe seeing things, not seeing things we shouldn't see. I don't think I worded that right. Sometimes if we see something that's not so good, it can have a bad effect on our hearts and our minds.
Mommy.
What? Okay, all right, hold on. So sometimes our parents don't want us to watch certain shows, right? Right. They are very careful about what we see, and they're very careful about what we do on the internet because they want to protect you, right? And they don't want you to have nightmares at night. So anyway, I just want to read to you in the book of Philippians, Paul wrote this, and I thought this was really cool. And it says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. So like the sunglasses protect our eyes, we need to protect our hearts and our minds and think of good things. That's my Bible. You want to look at it? Sure. So I'm going to wrap up this lesson. So anyway, yes, like sunglasses protect our heart, our eyes, we need to protect our hearts and our minds. So I have for you today a pair of sunglasses that you can take home and wear. And when you put them on, think about how you're going to protect your eyes, but you're also going to protect your heart and your mind for Jesus. I know my Bible's falling apart. It's okay. Here you go. Well, you can have another pair. Here, and take a pair for your brother, too. Okay, and there's for you. All righty. Okay, thank you. Now, we're going to go down to junior church. I got my sunglasses. We're going to go down to junior church, okay? Yes, everything will be nice and dark. You ready to go? Want to go down to junior church?
Yeah,
junior church. All right, let's go.
This is a time for us to pray for one another. I once heard someone talk about believing in the power of prayer. And someone else responded that they don't believe in the power of prayer. They believe in the power of God through prayer. If you think about that a little bit, think about the power of God through prayer, that God is always with us, guiding us, leading us. And we have a number of prayer cards this morning. Congratulations to Jim and Marlene Nye on their 62nd anniversary today. All right, congratulations. All right, I'm sorry, Jim and Marlene, who are you? They're right there. Okay, there you are. I'm learning. And you two met when you got married when you were 5 years old, right? Okay. From Lonnie. I had it down the other day. Turnip seed. Thank you. Lonnie, turnip seed. Healing of a back problem. Upcoming procedure this week. And thank you for your prayers for healing. That's from Lonnie Turnipseed. And from the Ryan Miller's neighbor, Barb, who needs prayer for her recovery from a devastating car accident. Let's keep Barb in our prayers. And I'm a little bit biased, but I just have a joy to share that my grandson, Levi, turns 4. So we're having a birthday party for him today. It's actually before his actual birthday, but looking forward to that time together later today. I also want to thank all of you for your faithfulness in giving, for those of you who have been coming here and putting it in the offering place in the back corner when you come into the narthex there. For many of you who are doing online giving, more and more people are doing that, finding that very convenient. For all of you who are online, who continue to give even when you are not present here in the sanctuary, your gifts and your faithfulness helps us to continue to be in ministry. And I like to say to folk that church never closed. Am I right? People say, well, I'm just so glad that church is open again. And I'll say, we never closed. We had to worship differently, but we never closed. And just as God is always with us when times are good and when times are tough, God is always with us. And so let us pray. Oh God, we sometimes cry out as a psalmist cried out and ask you to have mercy on us. Ask you to purify us and to create in us clean hearts. Because we have to admit, God, that there are those days when we wander away from you, when we get caught up in our own agendas, and when we allow the offenses of others to pull us in an unhealthy direction in our own lives. There are those days, God, when we are impatient and frustrated. Those days, God, when we walk away from you, when we try to take control of our own lives and even the lives of others around us. Oh God, create in us clean hearts. Wash away our sins. We give thanks for that gift of forgiveness through Jesus, through his death and his resurrection, and that you raise us up as well today. God, it would be so great if we could just say that prayer one time and be done, but we have to be reminded weekly, sometimes daily, sometimes hourly, to continue to follow where you lead. So continue to mold us from the inside out. Continue to share your love and your grace through the words that we speak and the lives that we live. And help us, God, to forgive each other just as you have forgiven us. We all mess up, God. Help us to have the same attitude that Jesus had and to be patient with each other, to love each other, to forgive each other, And we give thanks, too, for the gifts that we bring this morning. Not just gifts of checks or dollars and cents, but the gifts of our lives. We offer you, God, all that we are and all that we are so that you could work in us and through us within the four walls of this church and outside of the four walls of this church. Let your grace and your love be known through the words that we speak and the lives that we live. Amen. I really like preaching down front and being closer to you all. But when I watched the video, it seemed like I was really kind of dark and harder to see me. So give me some feedback, not right now, about which one seems to work better. If you're online, let me know whether it's better for me to be up front here or if it's okay for me to be down there. And same if you're in-house as well. I'm still trying to figure out where to go. So this is the only time I'm going to ask you to tell me where to go. Our character, our attitude, and our perspective in life matters. Character matters. And it affects everything that we say and everything that we do. So, think about when you've had a really bad day. We all have them, right? Now, years ago, someone gave me a book, The Terrible No Good Bad Day. Has anybody else ever read that book? Yeah. And we all have that terrible no good bad day at times, right? And when you come home after a terrible, no good, bad day, you're not in a very good mood, are you? I know I'm not. And so you bite everybody's heads off, right, when they talk to you, like, don't talk to me, don't look at me, leave me alone. And we kind of get gruff, don't we? And we kind of let the rough edges of our personalities show to the people closest to us. What do you do when you have a terrible, no good, bad day? Well, here's a couple things that I do, personally. Now, everybody has their own ways of dealing with that. Sometimes I just need to be alone. Don't want anybody around me. I remember many times when my kids were growing up and I had a bad day and I'd come home and they'd run up and they'd want to play or do something and I'd say to them, you might want to just stand back a little bit. Give me a couple minutes, and then I'll be with you, because I didn't have a good day today. And they would say the same thing to me. Sometimes I pray. Sometimes I go for a walk. I've found that walking is very therapeutic for me. I used to run, but now when I run, it looks more like a walk. Sometimes I talk about my day with a trusted friend, and I don't do that very often. I'm one of those guys, you know, I grew up with Clint Eastwood, you know, and kind of keep everything to myself, and I don't share a whole lot. Yeah, any other guys out there like that? Come on, I'm not the only guy, am I? All right, well, sometimes I just kind of keep it inside, and it takes a lot for me to share. I'm really good at listening to other people's problems. I'm not so good at sharing my own problems, but I've learned that when I do that, it can be very helpful. Sometimes I read the Bible, and I find encouragement. Sometimes I read the Bible, and I find it pushing me in a new direction that I may not want to go in. Sometimes I just take some deep breaths. I just breathe. And oftentimes I kind of combine walking with my camera. I am a camera buff, and I'll just go out in the park or in nature and just take pictures, and it's peaceful for me. It's calming for me. Those are some of the things I do. Now, you might have a whole different routine, but think about what you do when you're having a terrible, no good, bad day, when you're in a bad mood, and really you need to put up a sign that says, don't even come near me right now, right? What do you do to adjust your attitude? Because we don't want to stay in that place, do we? We all get there, but we don't want to stay there forever. And so Paul reminds us that our attitude and our perspective toward life, our character, matters. Let's take a look at this morning's passage of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 4, a couple of verses. Paul writes this. He says, therefore, I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with one another. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united. Now, notice it says united, right? It doesn't say untied. All right, somebody got it. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father who is over all and in all and living through all. However, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and to build up the church, the body of Christ. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith, believe that or not, right, in today's world, unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son, that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Now, Paul, then we will no longer be immature children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in what? In love. Growing in every way, more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. Paul, you can go back to the sermon slide. Paul spends time talking about who we are. He spends time talking about our character and our attitude before he goes on to talk about what we do. You see, our character determines our actions. And too often, we get it mixed up, don't we? And we focus more on what we do than on who we are. Think about that. Now, let's be honest, okay? None of us is perfect, right? How many of us here are perfect? I almost always get at least one hand. No? Okay. None of us is perfect. If you were to speak to my two daughters, who are now in their mid-30s, they can go on and on about all of my imperfections. Now, Ray's, I know your daughter would never have anything imperfect to say about you or your son, right? She's smiling. Family knows us best, don't they? We know the good and the bad of our family members. But the same is true for those of us in a church. None of us is perfect. None of us has it all together. Not the pastor, not the parishioners, none of us. We are a group of what the Bible calls sinners, giving thanks for God's grace and God's goodness. Sometimes we as a church do not reflect the attitude of Jesus. Hear that. Sometimes we as the church do not reflect the attitude of Jesus. Did anybody here see the movie 12 Years a Slave? Has anybody seen that? We got one person, two, a couple people have seen that. There's a scene in that movie that just drives me crazy. It is a scene where the plantation owner, the slave owner, forces the slaves to come to church on Sunday morning. It is not optional. And if you don't come, you're going to get beat. And so everybody's dressed up in their Sunday best, and the slave owner is standing up front reading from the Bible, praying. And then as soon as worship is over, the slave owner sends the slaves where? Back into the fields. And continues to abuse those slaves. There's a disconnect between the spoken word and the lived out word. Now that's drastic. But how often is there a disconnect for us today between what we say we believe and what we actually do? Now, I'm a camper. Well, not anymore. My grandson said, hey, abuelo, they call me abuelo. We're going to go camping. Do you want to go camping with us? And I said, I used to take your mom and your aunt camping all the time, but my camping days, I think, are done. Oh, abuelo, you want to go, don't you? Well, yeah, I do want to go. But I remember years ago working on a camp staff in Western Pennsylvania, paid staff. I was one of the counselors. And we were outdoors cooking a fire, right? Sometimes I do that. We were cooking on an open fire outdoors. And this was with a bunch of elementary age kids. And so one of the things you do as a counselor is you give them instruction about the right way to build a fire. And so I explained to them about the importance of that fire ring, the ring of rocks, and how important it is never to go inside that fire ring, to always stay outside of it when you're building the fire. And then I went through the different steps of tender and kindling and all of that stuff. And after I explained it to them, I went to show them how to build a fire. And so I got the tinder and the kindling and the wood, and I stepped inside the circle, and I'm, you know, getting the match. Did any of you catch that yet? Where am I? Where am I not supposed to be? And one of the girls caught me. She said, "Stu, I thought you said not to go inside the circle." And my first reaction was to say what? Do what I, not what I, yeah, that was my first reaction, but I was busted. She got me, and she was totally right. And sometimes we need to hear, as a church, do what you say, do what you say. Because we don't always do what we say, do we? There's two terms that have been kind of made famous lately, nuns and duns. Have any of you heard those two phrases, nuns and duns? Referring to Christians. Nuns are people who say that they have no religious affiliation whatsoever. Agnostic, atheist, etc. No religious affiliation. But duns are people who have been part of the Christian church and who have left the Christian church, who have given up on the Christian church, but not necessarily have given up on God, because they are not finding God in church. Because sometimes our words and our actions, what? Don't match. And so there's an increasing number of duns in our society today. People are done with church, frustrated because they can't find God in church. They haven't given up on God, but they've given up on church. In 2014, the Pew Religious Landscape Study was done. 7 years apart, 35,000 people in the 50 states here in the United States. Here's a couple things they found. The percentage of adults who describe themselves as Christian has dropped by nearly 8 percentage points in 7 years, from 78.4% to 70.6%, 8%. Number of people who call themselves Christian has declined. Over that same period, atheist, agnostic, or nothing in particular has jumped up more than 6 points, from 16.1% to 22.8%. More people claim to be agnostic or atheist or nothing today than 7 years ago. That's descriptive. But it says that more and more people are moving away from church. And there's no one reason. There's lots of reasons for that. But at the same time, I hear studies saying that more and more people are looking for God. So people are moving away from church, but they're still looking for God. Because there is a disconnect. Gordon MacDonald wrote an interesting book called Who Stole My Church? If you want a good read, it's an old book now. It came out, some time ago. I didn't write down the date when it came out. But it's been out for a while. It's a fictional story filled with real truths. And so in the book, he describes an imaginary church, but it's based on real church experiences. And I still remember reading one chapter where he was talking about a board meeting in this particular church, in this fictional church. And there was a disagreement during the board meeting, which is fine. People disagree, right? That's normal. But it got so bad that they started yelling and shouting and throwing chairs at each other. Now, a fictional church based on real church experiences. This has happened. Sometimes there's a disconnect for us, isn't there? I became a Christian in high school and started to get active in my church, and the first thing they did was put me on the church board. And you will find that I am very reluctant to put teenagers on the church board because it's a quick way to have them lose their faith. And I remember my first church board meeting. And there was an argument for 2 hours, 2 hours, over the color of a carpet in a Sunday school room. And that's when I felt God calling me to be a pastor, saying, God, it's got to be different than this. You got to make a difference. This is not what church is about. And people were calling each other names and yelling and screaming because they couldn't agree on what color a church carpet in a Sunday school room should be. Nothing wrong with disagreement, right? But it's the way they disagreed that turned me off. And I've seen it time and time again. A young person gets put on the board, they get disillusioned, they leave church. Because there's a disconnect. Sometimes we as a church fail to emulate or to imitate the character of Jesus. How are we sharing the love of Jesus with each other, with our neighbors, our friends, in our community? Jesus' disciples got frustrated with Jesus. There was this particular day when Jesus told his disciples that they were going to walk through the area called Samaria. And his disciples gave him a funny look, like no good Jew walks through Samaria. You know, sometimes if you've been in a big city, there are certain neighborhoods that you don't go through. In Jesus' time, you didn't go through Samaria because there was friction between the Jews and the Samaritans, or Samaritans were often known as half-Jews, kind of like the Hatfields and McCoys, you know, if you know that story from West Virginia. See, the Samaritans were considered to be half-breeds. From the time when the Babylonians and the Persians had defeated Israel and taken them into exile. Some of the people adapted during the time of exile. They intermarried with the people who had beaten them in battle. They took on some of the customs and traditions of their captors. And the traditional Jews saw them as traitors. And so they worshipped in different places. They had nothing to do with each other. And now Jesus was saying, okay, we're going to go through Samaria. And Jesus' disciples are saying, Jesus, you're nuts. We don't do that. Well, they go through Samaria. And it's impossible to walk through someplace without seeing somebody, right? And Jesus met a woman who came out to get water from a well. All by herself. That just didn't happen in those days. The fact that she was all by herself and no other woman with her was a sign that she was an outcast. She was unaccepted. She had to come by herself. And then Jesus walked up to this woman and began talking to her. Now, we can't understand that today because we would do that today, but in Jesus' day, that was unheard of, to speak with a woman, especially a strange woman, in public. It just wasn't done. I won't go through the whole story. You can check that out, the Gospel of John, chapter 4. You can read through the story. But the end of the story is this was a woman who had been through several husbands, was now living with a guy, had a lifestyle that many people today would condemn, and yet Jesus loved her and accepted her, and her life was transformed through that interaction with Jesus. He loved her first, and then she was changed, not the other way around. And she went out and got the townsfolk and said, "You've got to come see this man who knew everything about me and still accepted me." That's the model that Jesus gives us. Being like Jesus is not easy. It's tough. You see, Jesus was compassionate and caring. And yet at the same time, Jesus put people ahead of rules and traditions, and they got him in all kinds of trouble with the religious leaders. Jesus stood up against the religious hypocrisy of his day. And as a friend once said in his sermon, Jesus comforted the afflicted and afflicted the comfortable. Sometimes we make life and relationships more complicated than they need to be. Am I right? You know, we just like complicated. But author Robert Fulghum wrote in his book, "All I Really Need to Know, I Learned." Anybody read that book? "I Learned in Kindergarten." Geez, I could have just skipped all those other years of school. Save that money in graduate school, right? I'm going to read this to you, but I never get over these words. "All I really need to know about how to live and what to do and how to be, I learned in kindergarten. Wisdom was not at the top of the graduate school mountain, but there in the sand pile at Sunday school. These are the things that I learned. Share everything. Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. Most important one, flush. Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Learn some and think some and draw and paint and sing and dance and play and work every day some. This one I really miss. Take a nap every afternoon. When you go out into the world, watch out for traffic, hold hands, and stick together. Wonder. Remember the little seed in the styrofoam cup? The roots go down and the plant goes up, and nobody really knows how or why, but we are all like that. Goldfish and hamsters and white mice, even the little seed in the styrofoam cup, they all die, and so do we." And then, remember the Dick and Jane books, dating ourselves here? "And the first word you learned, the biggest word of all, look. Everything you need to know is in there somewhere. The golden rule and love and basic sanitation, ecology and politics and equality and sane living. Take any one of these items and extrapolate it into sophisticated adult terms and apply it to your family life or your work, or your government, or your world, and it holds true and clear and firm. Think, what a better world it would be if we all, the whole world, had cookies and milk about 3 o'clock every afternoon, and then lay down with our blankets for a nap, or if all governments had as a basic policy to always put things back where they found them and to clean up their own mess. And it is still true, no matter how old you are, when you go out into the world, it is best to hold hands and stick together. Paul said something very similar here in Ephesians, in one of my favorite chapters in the Bible, Philippians chapter 2. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? The character of a Christian. Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. You must have this same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being when he appeared in human form. He humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Remember that Jesus lived, was tried and crucified because he loved all of God's people, and he calls us to do the same. Amen. Let's change the slide to communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And let us, we're not there yet, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was crucified, he took bread, and he broke the bread, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you." He did this knowing that in just a few hours his disciples would abandon him, leave him all by himself as he was arrested and beaten and tried alone. He does this knowing that each of us falls short. And yet, Jesus offers us forgiveness, especially when we don't deserve it. And then Jesus took the cup, and he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me." Jesus chose to forgive when we should be condemned. He chose grace for you and for me. And so this morning, know that we are a forgiven people. We are not a perfect people. We are a forgiven people, surrounded by the grace of Jesus Christ, and we are invited to share that grace, that love of God, not just with each other, but with the world outside the four walls of this church. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. I invite you to take your little communion packet here. And we're going to take out the wafer, some with more success than others. So if you peel the plastic back on the top, you'll get the wafer. And if you have that, the body of Jesus Christ broken for you, take and eat and be thankful. And then peel back the foil carefully. The blood of Jesus Christ given for you. Take and drink this in remembrance. We are a forgiven people. Thanks be to God. Amen.
This is my story. This
now may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, continue to be with you today and every day, now and forever, as you go in peace. Amen.